Welcome everybody to this webinar hosted by Toradex with the title Jumpstart Your Next High-Speed PCB Design with Our Experts. This is the second part of a two-part webinar series with the name Build Your Own Carrier Board Easily. We have with us today our guest and partner Altium. So there is Vincent Maser, a product and personal marketing engineer from Altium with us. My name is Peter Lischer. I'm a senior hardware development engineer at Toradex. I'm working for Toradex for more than 12 years. If you have used a Toradex computer module in the past, the chances are actually pretty high that I was involved in the hardware development of this product. Before we dive into the webinar, let me cover a few organizational points. Please use the chat window of the webinar tool if you have any technical issues and wish to let us know. At the end, we will also do an interactive question and answer session. You can type your questions in the chat window at any time, and we will pick them up at the end. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing. What's on today's agenda? I will start with a brief introduction of Toradex. Then I will go into a theory block in which I talk first about field theories and signal return path. Then we talk about impedances and PCB stackups. And at the end of my theory block, I will talk about length matching. I will then hand over to Vincent for a live demonstration in Altium Designer in which he will show you how to do these things I've talked in my theory block. And at the end, we will do a question and answer session in which I will try, or we will try, to answer your questions. With this, let's get started. So who is Toradex? Toradex is focusing on to make embedded computing easy to use so that you can get simple access to the latest technology for your product development. We are doing this by providing a highly reliable ARM system on modules, which includes software and support. We are striving to offer the lowest total cost of ownership to you. This means, beside the price of the module, we also consider things like your development effort, time to market, and long-term maintenance. We are proud of being able to have industry-leading support, which includes a very active community, and a developer page with more than 800 articles, which are updated on a daily basis. As you can see on this map, we are located all around the world with local support and warehouses. I'm located in Lucerne in Switzerland, in our headquarters, and you've probably already noticed my Swiss German accent. This is our product folio. So we have three computer module families. It's the Apalis, the Colibri, and the very new Verdin. Within the family, the modules are pin compatible so that you can have an easy upgrade path for your designs. I don't want to talk more about computer modules and our product here because I have covered it in our first part of this webinar series. So if you're interested in our products and how to select these modules, please go and visit our recording of the first webinar. With this, let's get started with the actual topic we want to talk about today. I would like to start with a quote from Ralph Morrison. Buildings have walls and holes. People travel in holes, not the walls. Circuits have traces and spaces. Energy travels in spaces, not the traces. I took that quote from his book, Fast Circuit Boards, Energy Management, which I highly recommend. So what Ralph want to tell us here is that we actually have to make spaces. We don't have to design the traces, or we don't have to design the copper itself. So what we have to design on a PCB design is the space in which the energy travels. How does that look like? So a lot of times you see transmission lines are described with this little circuit in which is a chain of small inductances and capacitance. But the problem is that this circuit does not really give you the full truth about transmission lines. So what we have to do, we have actually to look the fields in a transmission line. So what we have here is a trace above a reference ground. It is rooted above a trace, above the ground. So what happens if we apply a voltage to this trace? So what we get is an electric field. And as soon as we have a current in the trace, what we also get is a magnetic field around the trace. So the trace here, the current flows into, so we see along the trace goes into infinite in this picture here. So what we have to consider is the electromagnetic field that we have between the trace and the reference ground, because the energy is in this electromagnetic field. It's not in the electrons that are in the copper. So because the electrons itself, they only move about a couple of centimeters per second, while the electric field itself, it moves with up to the speed of light, depending on your materials. Electromagnetic fields, they tend to want to spread out. So what we need to do is we need to make sure that we guide the fields, that we make proper walls for this field. So what we are trying to do is to make sure that we control the space here in between, that we can control the electromagnetic field between the trace and its reference. What does that mean in a real PCB design? So when you look at here, such a trace, it goes from a source to a sink. So of course the forward current is inside the trace itself, but the thing is, due to the field, the return path or the return current is not taking the direct path on the ground plane. So it's the current is not going back on the shortest path. So what happens is that our return path is following the forward current. So it follows the trace, because what we do is what we have actually is here between the trace and the ground plane, we have our space that we built. So our electromagnetic field is underneath here. So that means our return path is following our forward trace. This is really important to understand, because what happens if the return path cannot follow? So what happens if we design something like that? What happens if we have a source here, the sink on the other side, and in between we have a cutout, we have maybe an analog ground in between? So what happens is that the return path cannot really follow underneath, so it has to go out, which means our fields that we want to guide is spreading out. So we cannot guide anymore our electromagnetic field. And as soon as our field is spreading out, what we get is we are causing electromagnetic interferences. So we are getting into trouble with electromagnetic compatibility. So we really need to avoid the situation in which our field cannot is not guided because our return current cannot follow. So what we need to do is we need to route around this reference plane in order to make sure that our return path can really follow our forward path, so that we can really guide our field. What if we cannot avoid a split plane? So what if we have, for example, a source which is referred to a ground plane, and we have a sink that is referring to a power plane? Of course, first thing is you should really try to avoid these situations. But if you cannot avoid it, what happens is that the return path cannot follow anymore. So the electromagnetic field will spread out and it will find its way, but it's not going where you want to have it. So it's going where it causes problems. So if we really cannot avoid this situation, what we can do at least is try to create a return path for our current. So we can try to add here a stitching wire, a stitching capacitor as close as possible to the forward trace, that at least the return path can follow our forward path. The problem with that is that capacitors have parasitic inductances, and that produces a self-resonance. Therefore, stitching capacitors only work up to a few hundred megahertz. So the best way is actually really try to avoid any situation in which we have to route over split plane. What is if we change layers? So for example, here we have a signal that is on the top layer and goes into the bottom layer. So the top layer is referred to the second layer, which is ground plane, and the bottom layer is referred to the third layer ground. The problem here is that, again, the return path cannot really follow. So we need to make sure that our return path can follow when we change planes. So what we need to do is we should add stitching vias. So we stitch the two ground planes together as close as possible to the place in which we change our layers. We should do that symmetrical if in case of a differential pair here. And anyway, we should try to limit the amount, or we should try to really make sure that we don't have too many vias in a transmission line, because every time we do change layers, it can cause issues with the return path and with how we guide our fields. You may think, well, how does this actually affect me? I'm not really doing high-speed designs. The thing is that what high speed is not really defined by the clock frequency of a signal. What matters is the slew rate of a signal. So the thing is that the slew rates in the last couple of years, they have massively increased because transistors are getting smaller and smaller in integrated circuits, which means that drivers are switching faster and faster. So we're getting higher slew rates. I mean, when we have, for example, a rise time of 10 nanoseconds, up to traces up to 45 millimeters on an outer layer or 35 millimeters on inner layers, we're not really having that many problems. So we can get along with not considering return path and all these kind of things. But if you have longer traces, you should really consider it. The thing is now, if we have rise times of 0.5 nanoseconds, which is a common value, this critical length are going down to maybe 2.2 millimeters for microstrips and 1.8 millimeters for strip lines. And this includes even inside package the length. So which means we basically have almost every time to consider the route properly. So what we can do if we really don't need high speed signals, but we still have these high slew rates, what we can do is trying to reduce the rise times. So whenever it's possible, we should actually try to reduce it. On a lot of SoCs, you can do that by going into register settings. You can reduce slew rates. You can reduce the drive strength output of an I/O. If you cannot do that, what you can do is placing some series resistors as close as possible to the source of the signal in order to reduce the slew rate. With that, I would like to do a first little break here and do a short poll with you. I would like to know from you whether you have been considering a signal return path in your last designs. So possible answers are no, it's the first time that I'm actually hearing about this theory. No, but I will try to take care in my next designs. No, I don't think it's needed. My designs have always worked without it. Yes, I always try to follow this guideline. Or no, I've never done PCB designs so far. Okay, I will keep rolling it for a little bit longer. Votes are still coming in. Okay. I'm going to close the poll and going to share with you the results. It's actually pretty interesting. So most of you, more than half of you, have already following these guides, and that's good. That's good. That's really good news, because it's really necessary that you try to really make sure that you guide your return path. Okay, let's talk about impedances. So what is actually an impedance? Well, the impedance is the resistance of the space we are building. So it's not a real resistor. So it's basically what a signal sees when it enters a transmission line. An open transmission line, open space transmission line has 337 ohms. Which is really the maximum we can get as impedance. So very often you see 50 ohm impedances. That's a good compromise between really an open one and the minimum we can do. So this formula here is a really simplified formula how to calculate this impedance. So it is, the impedance is the square root of the inductance over the capacitance of a trace. On a trace itself, the inductance, we cannot really change much by changing the geometry of the trace. So there we cannot play a lot with it. So the main thing we can change is the capacity of the trace. So when you look at the trace, a trace looks like a parallel plate capacitor. And with that simplified formula here, it's a really simplified formula here, you can see how we can change the impedance and the capacity of our trace by changing the width, the height, and the material, so the electric constant. So when I make a trace wider, that means I increase the capacity, which then means that I lower the impedance. And the other way around, if I increase the distance between the trace and the ground, that means I lower the capacity and increase the impedance. Why is impedance matching so important? So the thing is, or ideally, the source has an internal resistance of 50 ohm, so it's driving with 50 ohm, then the signal that comes out of this source sees a transmission line with 50 ohm, and when it exits the transmission line, it sees again a termination with 50 ohm. That's the best case, that's where we get the best quality of signals. What happens if we have some mismatches in between there? So what we get on mismatches is that parts of the signals are getting reflected on the mismatches. Reflection means that signals can travel back and forth. They get reflected. So they maybe arrive a second time at the sink, and we get something like a second wave that arrives, which then can violate setup and hold time, or can really degrade our signal quality. And in worst case, what can happen is that we make the transmission line exactly the length that you get a standing wave. And that would be really the worst one, because that is basically what you have in an antenna. When you create an antenna, you want to have the standing waves. And we really want to avoid these standing waves. So ideally, really every section should have the same impedance like the sink and the source. But sometimes you have situations in which you have a driver which has a lower internal resistance, for example, like 10 ohms, and you want to drive something. How can you deal with that? So what you can do is actually place a series resistor as close as possible to the source in order to make sure that you get driving resistance here of 50 ohm, that you get really impedance matched from start to the end. So we have already seen how the trace geometry creates the different impedance and how how it is calculated easily with this really simplified formula. The thing is actually, when you look at the real trace, there is way more that influences the impedance. So it's not only these really simplified formulas that you can use. So in order to get the impedance, what you need is actually field resolver for doing that. The good news is that Altium 20 has a built-in field resolver, which is actually pretty capable. But if you don't have Altium 20 or you want to use a different one or you don't have one, what I highly recommend you to talk to your PCB manufacturer, because they can really help you also with these calculations, because they should have field resolvers and they know how to calculate these impedances. Another important thing is that even though if you get something like as a requirement 50 ohms plus minus 10%, you should actually design for precise 50 ohms, because you want to leave these tolerances to the PCB manufacturing process, because they need these tolerances. So please really try to design your traces as perfect as possible. Before I want to talk about differential impedance, I want to shortly go and look what differential signals actually are. So on a single-ended signal, what we have is actually one signal, and at the sink, there is a threshold voltage in which we decide whether it's a one or a zero. And the problem with it is that whenever you have a disturbance, and the disturbance goes into this threshold, you can end up having wrong zeros and ones, which causes then errors. On the differential pair, on the other side, you have two complementary signals, which means every time one goes up, the other one goes down. That makes then the receiver only needs to care about the difference between these signals. It had a really big advantage, so that whenever you have a disturbance which is on both signals, so if both signals are going up due to disturbance, you're not having problem with receiving the correct 0 or 1, because you're only interested in the difference between these. So this made it possible that differential pair signals are getting really small voltages. So maybe you're having 200, 300 millivolts instead of 1.8 or whatever on a single ended. But there is one big misconception on differential pairs signals. So the thing is that in many design guides and reference designs, you see that you should route your differential pairs with 100 ohm limits, for example, differential impedance. The thing is actually, differential pairs also consist of single-ended drivers. So the single-ended impedance on the differential pair signal is actually more important than the differential impedance. So when you look at the traces here, what influences them, the thing is that actually the field between the traces and the reference plane is actually bigger or more dominant than actually the field between these two signals. So as you can see here, the single-ended impedance is more important than the differential. What you can also see is that differential impedance is always smaller than 2 times the single-ended impedance. Here you see some typical impedances that are used. Okay, in order to get these impedances, you have to do a proper PCB stackup. The thing is, you should start with a PCB stackup before you're actually starting with the layout. And you should really work closely with your PCB manufacturer, because it's important to understand what he is able to produce, what is actually producible. First, I want to talk about two-layer stackups. The thing is, for impedance-controlled traces, two-layer stackups are not really a good fit. I mean, it is possible to do it, but the thing is, if you want to do, like we have seen before, a signal on the top layer and the reference on the ground, the problem with a two-layer board or regular two-layer board is that if you have a pretty big distance between these two layers. So in a 1.6 millimeter board, this distance is so big that a 50 ohm trace would be ridiculously wide. So something like 1.5 millimeters wide, which is not, which you cannot deal anymore. So you should go at least with a four layer stack up. A very common one you see on the left here, on the left one, we have one in which we have high speed signals on the top, then we have a ground plane, then we have power on layer three and some other signals on the bottom layer. It's a very common one, but it's not an ideal one because here on the top, it's okay. But on the bottom here, we have signals referring to power plane, which we have already seen before. It's not easy to handle because we need to make sure that we can properly stitch them, that we have that also the sync and the receiver, they really need to be able to refer to these power plates. So it's not easy to handle. And the other problem is that the power is actually pretty far away from ground, which also makes power distribution harder. So what is more recommended is using something like that, having two ground layers on layer two and three, and then do the signals and the power both on top and bottom. It's a bit harder to do, but gives you better results. If you go up to a six layer board, here on the left, I have a really bad one, bad examples in which we have a ground and a power plane in middle. Then you have tried to do some high speed signals on layer two and five, and then some low speed signals on the top and bottom. The problem is here that there is no real reference for these low speed signals. So they have to go through the high speed signals to get some reference. And that is really bad because you're coupling really into the high speed signals. So you should really avoid a stack up like that. So a slightly better or actually better one is the one in the middle in which we have a high speed signal on the top. Then we have power plane, two low speed signals in the middle, ground plane, and on layer six, bottom layer, some high speed signals. The problem here is that the two inner layers, layer three and four, in this stack up here, they are actually really close together while they have some distance to the actual ground plane and power plane, which means they really couple into each other. So it's really also hard to handle. So what I would recommend is something like here on the right side, in which we have two ground planes on layer two and five. And then in the middle here, we use an approach in which we do low speed signals and ground and power combined. So every time you route a low speed signal, you also place a ground plane on the other side then. So you kind of make a mixture to really make sure that you handle the return path within the layer two and three and four, so that they are mainly referring to each other. So with that, I would like to start a second poll. So in this poll, I'm really curious to hear from you how many layers your normal designs normally have. So whether you have done actually already PCB designs, whether you're using two layers, four layers, eight layers, or even more than eight layers. Okay, I will keep the poll rolling for a few more seconds. Okay, I'm going to close it and share with you the results. It's actually very interesting. So most of you, more than half of you, are doing four layer boards. It's also really the most common layer count, especially when you do carrier board design for our modules. Thank you very much. Now, coming to the last part of my theory block, I want to talk about length matching. So why do we actually need length matching? So length matching very often is needed when you have signals that have a clock and you have data signals or an interface with clock and data signals, and the data signals need to arrive within a certain setup and hold time. This means actually what we need to do is we need to match time. You're not really matching length, so we need to match the propagation time. Because the thing is that the speed of the signals is actually not constant. So it depends where you are on the PCB. So when you look at this formula here, that's a simplified formula of the propagation speed. So the propagation speed is more or less the speed of light divided by square root of the electric constant epsilon r. As we have on the outer layers, we have more air involved, so we have a lower epsilon r. The speeds on the outer layers are actually faster than in layers. So we need to understand that we have slightly higher speeds on the outer layer than on the inside of the board. The other thing we have to understand is that not all signals are the same. So when you look at this table here, you see a comparison between PCI Express and an SD card interface. I mean, PCI Express can get really, really fast, really high frequencies. Even Gen 4 now is even doubling the speed. Looking at these numbers, you could think that PCI Express need to be matched way better than an SD card interface. But the thing is that PCI Express actually has an integrated clock. It doesn't really need the clock for detecting the data stream itself. Therefore, on PCI Express, the requirements to match between clock and data pairs are way less strict than on an SD card. So instead of 1.6 nanoseconds on PCI Express, you actually should match an SD card with 20 picoseconds. So always keep in mind that you need to understand your signals. Here are a few kind of do's and don'ts how you should do matching. So first thing here is that you should try to match or to compensate any length differences as close as possible to the mismatch. That goes also for bendings, so please compensate as close as possible to any bendings. If you have bendings then that compensate each other, you don't need to compensate them as long as they're close together. So I wrote down here about 50 millimeters. But if you change layers, you should really compensate before changing layers, because you want to have the signals in sync when they're changing layers, because every time you have a via, there is potential to get in disturbances, and you want to have the disturbances coming in synchronous, that it, they cancel out. You should always match before changing layers. And of course, you should try to avoid the need for any compensating. So maybe you just make sure that you get a nice breakout of a package. And the last thing here I want to show you here is that if you have to match two signals with each other, try to route them on the same layers, because as we have seen, signals are not having the same speed on all the layers, so it's easier to match them if they are routed on the same layers, because then the speed hasn't the biggest influence anymore. With that, I'm concluding the theory block, and I would like to have a last poll with you. I would like to know from you whether you have done length matching in the past. So possible answers are, I don't do it. I don't think it's required for my designs. I didn't do it yet, but I will try to consider it in my next design. And another option is, yes, I do it manually, or yes, I do it with the built-in features of my CAE tool. Okay, I'm rolling it for a few more seconds. Okay, I'm going to close it and show you the results. Actually, really good. You're a good audience. You're actually also doing length matching. Very, very good. And you're taking advantage of the built-in features of the CAE tool. That's good. With that, I actually want to hand over to Vincent. He was going to show you how you can do all these kind of things with Altium Designer.
Okay, thanks a lot, Peter. My name is Vince Mazur, and I'm a product marketing engineer here at Altium. What we're going to talk about today is give you a brief overview of Altium, and then we're going to go into a demonstration where I'll show the layer stack manager. We'll create some impedance profiles. We'll show how to assign that to specific nets. We'll do some length tuning and matching, and even show some newer capability for return path checks. So let's talk about Altium. Altium started in 1985, and it started in Australia, and their flagship product back then was called Protel. One of the things that differentiated that company at the time in the electronics design automation industry was the fact that it ran on Windows. Most tools at that time ran on Unix. And also its price point was very attractive relative to other alternatives. You know, since then we've really grown. We're a corp or a global company. We're headquartered in San Diego. We have regional headquarters in Munich and Shanghai. The product is used ubiquitously throughout the industry. It's the largest the most widely used printed circuit board design package on the planet. We have a variety of customers, as you can see here. One of the newer aspects of our company, this is pretty exciting, and it's been very relevant with the global pandemic, is we have a platform. It's a cloud platform called Altium 365, and that actually comes with our product today when customers are on subscription. And what that really means is that you can take your entire environment with you from the standpoint of libraries, design management, all of your component information. It doesn't matter where you are, you can access this uncompromised, in addition to being able to collaborate with your co-designers. It's very exciting, and you know, we were able to leave our offices when we were given the work at home directive, and we still had our entire environment there. So at this point, let me go ahead and go into the demonstration. So I've got Altium Designer here. I've got a older carrier board design, and what I'm going to do first is I'm going to go into the layer stack manager. So the layer stack manager, this is already set up. You can see we're looking at the side of it, basically. You can see very similar to the diagrams that Peter showed in his presentation. We can come in here and we can define, you know, what type of material that we're going to be using for, you know, in between the layers, and such. And then go ahead and move this window out of the way here. We can access our material library, and we can, you know, choose the type of material, and we've got the stack up here. I'm just going to go with this for now. Now, the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to go look at impedances. And right now, this design, it wasn't originally done with this capability, so there are no impedance profiles. I'm going to go ahead and add one, and it defaults to 50 ohms. As Peter mentioned, it's a commonly used impedance. And what we do is the solver immediately calculates the various traces and widths and parameters to achieve that impedance. So we see here on the top layer, we get a cross-sectional view of our trace and our reference plane. And we see that we're within 0.04% of our target impedance. This takes into account all kinds of aspects. It takes into account the etch back factor that you would get from your fab house. You have the ability to choose the type of modeling that you would want to use to come up with this. You can, you know, change the trace widths. If you have a desired trace width you want to use, you can calculate for that. If I look at my inner layer, we get again that cross-sectional view. Got the 50 ohms here. It takes into account mask layers. You have the ability to even add multiple layers of prepreg to come up with, coefficients that are going to meet the needs of your design. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to add another impedance profile that we're going to use in the design during this demonstration. It's going to be a differential profile, and I'm going to go ahead and make that target impedance 90 ohms. And I'll get rid of this here. And so now we see that we get different cross sections. You notice here that the solver is recommending a 0.127 millimeter trace gap. I highlight that because we'll reference that when we get into the actual board design. And again, you can change any of these parameters. If you want a specific width, you can solve for that. It will adjust the gap and whatnot. So I'm good to go here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and save that. And it actually saves it into the printed circuit board environment or printed circuit board design. And I'm in the 3D mode right now. One of the things that I have up here is what we call the PCB Explorer. It's a very useful way to explore the various signals that you have on your board. Now, this design was very well done. They have, all of the various signals separated out in what we call classes. Let me go ahead and go into the 2D domain here. And likewise, we can see all of these. This is a SATA bus, PCIe bus. And if I go down here to the CSI bus, I have an unrouted differential pair. And the first thing I want to show you is how we take that impedance profile and map it to our signals. I just have a small example here. Right here, this is the existing rule, but because I do have a impedance profile, we're able to just specify that. Now, if I had multiple differential profiles, they would show up here. I just have the one for now. So now let me go ahead and route this guy. You can choose this here. Meander up here. Okay, we'll continue. That's not really what I was looking for, but should work for the purposes of this discussion. Okay, so we've routed this differential pair. So what I want to do is come in here and measure this gap, and I can do that. And we see that we get the 0.127. Okay, so I've routed that differential pair. The other aspect I want to do is I want to move into tuning. Now, when we tune a differential pair, I think of it as like a coarse grain tuning and a fine-tuned grain tuning. The first thing I want to do is tune for the actual length of the differential pair route. So what I can do is just come in here and I can choose my differential pair. And then I'm going to get my tuning indicator. Now, what I'm going to do is go into my properties panel here, and I'm just going to set 60 millimeters for that. I want those to be tuned to 60 millimeters. Now, we see this gauge here. And we see on the right, I've got the 60 millimeters. So when I get to that point, let me go ahead and start farther back here. We can also change our tuning pattern and just scroll through these. I'm hitting the space bar. And then we can go ahead and move this. These are like you know, intelligent blocks. They're part of the design, and you can move them around. Comes in handy, you know, as you're trying to clean things up and whatnot. Okay, so that works. So again, going back to the Explorer, we see that we have this signal is the one that I'm routing, and we see that our lengths they're real close, but they're not completely matched. We need to put a little more distance on this net here, or excuse me, this one right here. So what I'm going to do is come in here, and we'll just go in this area and do tuning of a single-ended signal. And I again go to the properties panel, and I actually want to match it to a net. And it's that CSI positive there. And now I it's just a little bit of a tuning here. So at this point, I'm all tuned up. And I look at the lengths here and I see that they are equal. The next thing I want to show is I've got a parameter for this trace right here, for this net, that is actually set to a time. Why don't I show that to you real quick? We've got this set to a minimum delay of 1,055 picoseconds, maximum delay of 1,065. So now if I come in here to tune this net, let me get into my tuner here. We're going to get a slightly different setup with the tuning indicator. Go ahead and what I need to do is I need to change this to go from rules right here. And then now this is that rule that I just showed you. And then when I come in here, we get our pattern. And you see that as I get within the range of acceptance, it turns green. I can also, you know, change the pattern, make it bigger, do something like this. There. So we've tuned that. Finally, I want to go ahead and run a rule check here. Let me go ahead and just move this guy a little closer down here. And I've got a rule here. It is a return path, and I've got this filtered. And I'm just going to run this actual rule. And we'll, the return path, let me go ahead and just let this run, and then I'll show you what that is. But basically what we're doing is we're making sure none of the traces are outside of the boundaries of the return path. Because as Peter was saying, this can cause all kinds of problems, can result in the return path going in such a way that you land up taking a lot of that energy and radiating it out. This takes a little while to run on this design. It's checking all of that geometry. And if there's, we are finding some violations there. And we'll explore what's going on as soon as this completes. And this is a relatively new capability in our product. And we're continually upgrading our high-speed capabilities to meet the demands of this challenging segment. So I see I've got a bit of a violation here. Okay, it highlights it. Well, I had a layer turned off, and I forgot that I had a little slot here. So that's the problem. I mean, I moved the tuning area away from that, I'll have no problem, or I can just simply delete the slot. And when I run that again, it will report no violations. I just want to wrap up showing a really nice capability. Like I said, this board was routed before this capability was included in Altium Designer. And if for some reason I wanted to say, take if I wanted to take one of these already existing routes, I can go ahead and reroute that by just doing the retrace. And what it does is it applies those rules with that impedance matching that's tied into the layer stack that we've created, and it reroutes that trace. Now, we would need to go in there and do some fine tuning, but I show this because if for some reason your stackup changes or something changes, you're able to recoup most of your work. And that's really all I had at this point. Certainly, if you're interested in our products, they're available at our website, free evaluations. And you're welcome to make a note of my information here. And if you have any questions after this webinar, you can feel free to reach out. And that's all I have for now. And I'll turn it back over to the organizer.
Okay. Thank you, Vincent. I have one short thing I want to do before starting the Q&A or show you. It is how you can get some more help from Toradex. So we have this layout design guide on our website, which has some more information of do's and don'ts, what you should do and shouldn't do on designs. You can also get in touch with us. The best way is using our community website. Here you can place your questions. You can even do that privately, that you, if you don't want to share any information with competitors. We also have on our website a lot of Altium project files available, free to download. So you'll find all the reference designs of our carrier boards there. And if you don't use Altium Designer, you can use the embedded Altium Designer web viewer to browse through our designs and see how we have done the layout on our designs. With that, I would like to start with the question and answer session. So let's see what questions we got in so far. Okay, so the first question is actually for Vincent. I have the question which a guy is asking, Altium is very expensive for me. For my hardware design, I'm using KiCad. Does Altium have a free version for learning? Vincent, can you take that over?
Yes. We have the product is called Circuit Maker, and that is a free product. I don't know that it's going to currently have all of the capability I showed in this demonstration. We also have a university program. If you're a student, you can get discounted pricing for Altium Designer. Also, just want to mention that, you know, we are offering our product on a subscription basis, and we're finding that some individuals and companies find that financial model is more attainable for them.
Okay, thank you. So the next question is, how many layers do you think has a Toradex computer module? Yes, that's an interesting question. So Some of our modules have 8 layers, the cheaper ones, and it goes up to 14 layers. So we have up to 14 layers on our computer modules because we put a lot of complexity inside a module that it makes it possible then to just do a 4 or 6 layer board on your carrier board. What is the biggest challenge in designing a computer module? So, as I said, we have up to 14 layers. And when you compared it, these 14 layers, so what I have on these 14 layers is actually only six layers are signal layers. So I need 4 layers just ground and another 4 layers only for bringing in the power, because on a lot of computer modules, bringing in all the power is really a big challenge. I haven't been talking in this webinar so far about power delivery, because that's an own kind of important task. We were not able to scratch that here. But yeah, bringing in power is very often a big challenge in a design. The second question was about the impedance matching on your carrier boards. First of all, we do impedance matching on our modules. So the modules are matched, and they're within the values we give you on our design guide. So you find in the design guide to which impedance you should match your carrier boards. The carrier boards we are doing, they're also matched. So they're matched with the stackup we are using for our carrier boards. Next question I got in was, wait, you're talking about AC current in return path. Yes, we are talking about AC current in the return path, but the thing is, I mean, return path is really something you have to consider for everything about above a few kilohertz, and consider even for DC, for the power rails. We haven't talked about power distribution so far because I didn't have enough time to talk about power distribution. But even in power distribution, return path is a really important thing, because even if you have something like a DC power rail, you have AC parts on it. You have the kind of the peak currents, which are higher frequencies. So also these ones you have to handle with the return path. So really make sure that you really handle everything as good as possible with the return path. What else do we have as a question? Would you please speak about a century of different signals like Ethernet, I2C, and SPI? Yes. So first with Ethernet, I mean, you're probably about talking about differential pair, the media dependent signals, the signals that are coming out of the Ethernet PHY and go into the magnetics or the magnetics with connector. So these ones, you should definitely try to, I mean, first of all, try to make them as short as possible if you get, because if you have shorter traces, you can get away with a lesser, or kind of with a worse, or having less problems when you have not perfectly matched it or having issues with return path. But you should definitely consider them as to route them good. Then when it comes to I2C and SPIs, I mean, SPIs can run, depending what your needs are, but they can run in a few megahertz. So I definitely would consider these signals to route as good as possible with return path and impedances. About I2Cs, I mean, I2Cs, depending again what speed of I2C signals you have, I2C can go up to, I think it's 3.4 megahertz with a higher end, with a lower for a couple of hundred kilohertz. The thing is, on I2C you have pull-up resistors, so the rising of the signal is normally not having a bigger slew rate, but the falling edge of the signal. So it's an asymmetrical signal. So the falling part of an I2C signal can have a higher slew rate and can therefore also cause problems. So whenever it is possible for you, try to follow the rules also on the I2Cs. But of course, it always is, you should try to make kind of a first look at the really critical signals and then go back to the less critical and then try also to route these ones as good as possible. At the end, it's always about making compromises. So then there is another remark more that I got. He says, breaks in signal path always create issues in our designs. Yes, that's true. So always when you kind of have break in the return path, it really, that is what's causing issues. That was is mainly causing EMC issues when you're failing in EMC testing. Then what else do we have? Can pouring ground polygon on the signal layer change the impedance? Yes, it can. I was actually, it was interesting. I was in a conference, it was an Altium conference, and there was a really a high speed, or it was a presentation about really dealing, how you should deal with such high speed designs, how you should do a return path and all these kind of things. And there were actually, there was a debate between two experts whether ground pouring is a good or a bad thing. So one expert said, well, you should do it, and the other one said you shouldn't do it. The thing is, or the outcome is basically, if you do ground pouring, you should know what you're doing. Because the worst thing you can do is actually pouring ground on a single layer and just leaving it there, not having enough vias to stitch it actually to the other ground layers, because that can cause more problems than it solves. So I rather tend to not pour grounds over the signal layers, because yes, first it can change impedances. So you can then have impedance discontinuous if you don't pour it everywhere. And the other thing is, it can actually cause more problems that it solves. Then another question was, why could not use power planes as reference? Well, the thing is, first of all, in order to use a ground plane as a reference, actually the signal sink and the source need also be able to refer to it. So you actually, the return current needs to go into the power plane. So that means that, I mean, as long as this power rail belongs to the sink and source device. So if you have, for example, a source, a driver, which uses 3.3 volt, so it actually uses already the 3.3 volt power plane. So it's easier to refer a signal to this 3.3 volt rail if it actually uses the 3.3 volt in the driver. But if it doesn't use it, then you somehow need to be able to, that your return current is able to go into that power plane, which means you need to have extra stitching capacitor there to actually stitch it to it, that the return path can go into the power plane. And as we have learned in my theory block, stitching capacitors are okay, but they only work off, until a certain frequency. So it is not easy to use. So try to not do it whenever it is possible. Then what else do we have? Peter, do I need to control length matching for RGB signals? You probably mean the parallel RGB signals of an LCD interface. The thing is, they are running in a rather, let's say, we are there probably at around, yeah, maybe 100 megahertz with the clock speed. So at 100 megahertz, we are maybe a, we are not that, so we are probably in a range of about, yeah, let's say, about maybe 50 millimeters that we should match them within. So it's basically quite relaxed. It also depends, of course, on the resolution of your RGB interface. So if you have higher resolution, the chances are higher that you should match them, length match them. If you have a lower resolution, it's probably not necessary. The other thing is, as Vincent have shown you, how easy it is to match signals in Altium Designer. So basically, if it's so easy, why not doing it? It doesn't really hurt doing it. Does Toradex perform EMC testing on all of all its carrier board without any enclosure? That's a really good question. So the thing is that EMC testing you can only do with a complete system. So you cannot do EMC testing with just the module or just the carrier board. You always have to test the complete system. So module with carrier board, with enclosure, if your final system has anything, and with even peripherals. The thing what Toradex does is we do test our modules with some of our carrier boards. So for example, when you have our development boards, they are not tested in the EMC chamber because they are not really optimized for EMC performance. So what we do is, for example, on the Apollis line, we tested with the smaller one, with the smaller carrier board, with the Xora. And we mainly do that because we want to see how easy it, whether it's actually possible to pass with our modules. So we are more interested in testing actually the modules than actually testing the carrier boards, because at the end, it's not the final product. You can only test the final product. So at the end, even if we test our carrier board, that doesn't mean that you're not, you still need to test your own complete design with enclosure, with everything. Some more questions. Trace matching on a top layer design does not make sense from my point of view because the wire length difference of each TD pair is so big in Ethernet cable compared to PCB, or I am wrong. Yes, it's actually a good point. So when you have on an Ethernet cable, between the differential pairs, length matching makes less sense within the differential pair because the Ethernet cable itself has a lot of length difference. But what you should do is match between the positive and negative signal inside of a differential pair. Because again, what you want to make sure is that your signals are synchronous when they change, for example, change layer or go into the connector. So I highly recommend at least make sure that you match the positive and negative part of your Ethernet signal. I2C signals can be routed as differential. Not really. I2C signals are not differential signals because differential signals are really when you have two signals that are complementary. So one goes up, the other one goes down. So an I2C signals are really two different signals. So of course you can route them kind of, I always do that to route them kind of on the same path because you anyway have to go to the same path with these signals, but they're not really differential signals. Referring to Q about power plane, how about if we separate the power plane, a power with a ferrite bead? Well, ferrite beads are actually very often causing more problems than they solve, because with the ferrite bead, you block high frequencies, which means every time you use a ferrite bead, you block also return path. So you block all the high speed part of a signal if you use it as a return path, of course. But even for power delivery, when you have a CPU that you or a board that you have that you power, the power is not constant. So you have peak powers that you have to deliver. So which means you have high frequency parts within the power delivery. So if you put a ferrite bead, what you do is actually blocking that the demanding peak power cannot come anymore. So it actually can cause more problem than it solves. Next question is, which tool is Toradex using for designing their PCBs? So since many, many years, we are using Altium Designer for our carrier boards because we are sharing our designs with our customers. And that was always the best way because it's the widest spread tool. Until recently, we have used Mentor Graphics Expedition for our modules because Altium was, we were not able to do so compact designs in Altium Designer, but we just changed to use also Altium Designer for our computer modules because Altium has improved in the last couple of years really a lot that nowadays we are really able to do complex designs in Altium Designer. So nowadays we are working completely in Altium Designer at Toradex. Then there is next question. Is Altium 365 available in India? Is it an annual subscription? Vincent, can you take over that question?
Yeah, it's available globally. It's a cloud service. It would be best to talk to your salesperson or go to our website and enter the chat as far as subscription. But I can tell you, you get access to Altium 365, what we call Altium 365 standard, with your current subscription of Altium Designer. It comes with it. And that includes, you know, design, storage and management, components, capabilities that help you with component selection based on availability and stock levels and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
And it renews as you renew. It's just something that you get with it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then I have a next question is, how should we locate stitching capacitors? Should we add for every high-speed line when reference is VCC? Well, you should get them as close as possible. Of course, you can share stitching capacitors. If we have, for example, between two high-speed signals, you put one stitching capacitor. But you should place as many as possible of these. But the best is always to really not to refer signals on VCC. Try to keep it on ground because it's so much easier and you are having less troubles. Next question, which VIA technology do you recommend? Well, it really depends on your board. You should always try to get the cheapest technology you can solve your designs. So some of our modules, the simpler ones, we even only use through-hole vias on the boards. But as soon as we get into more complex designs on the modules, we use buried and blind vias, and we even have some modules in which we do double stacked blind vias because otherwise we cannot break out a processor which has 1,500 balls. That's really a matter of how complex your design is. I always try to challenge myself to the cheapest kind of way PCB I can do. So I try to reduce the amount or that I'm not needing special VIA technologies. Next question, best layout for chassis ground or for Ethernet and system ground? That's a really tough one because it's not easy to answer. So, the thing is that chassis ground has nothing to do with the return path itself. So it's really something you have to separate from the rest of the ground planes internally. So what we found is one of the best approaches is actually to make a chassis ground and then add a capacitor and mega ohm resistor to bridge it to the regular ground. But it's really something you can ask two different people and get three different opinions on it. Do you have any tips for design starting with proper EMC implementation in mind? Yes, the biggest tip is always start with the stack up and impedance in mind. So that's really something you should really start with. So really talk to your PCB manufacturer, what he is capable, how can you reach the required impedance you want to have. So that is really the biggest tip I can give you. And then always start with the most critical signals when you route it, and then go down to the less critical, because you want to do it always as good as possible. But of course, it's always a matter of violating rules. So the kind of the difficulty in layouting is always which rules can I violate when. And the last question that came in is, I wonder if you can do impedance matching with a two-layer PCB without a reference layer. Yes, it is theoretically possible. So you can do coplanar references. So that means you route a signal and on next to it, on both sides, you actually put ground to it, to refer to it. But it's way more difficult to handle, because you may have to make sure that these grounds are really well referred. You cannot just put a ground, like ground flooding, next to a signal and hope that it is working as a reference, because you really have to make sure that the return current can go flow in this trace next to the actual signal trace. So that's why I highly recommend not doing two-layer PCBs, really go to at least a four-layer board. I mean, four-layer board are not anymore that expensive, so you avoid so much trouble by just adding two extra ground layers in between and have a proper grounding. Okay, with that, we are already a bit over the time. I would like to wrap it up, because we have really a limited time for this webinar. I thank you very much for your interest. Of course, we have only been able to scratch the surface of high-speed PCB design. So if we want to know more, there are very interesting webinars also available on the Altium websites, and you can find a lot of books regarding this topic. I hope you were able to get some ideas and useful information for your next design. A special thanks goes also to Vincent and Altium for helping us out for this live demonstration. Thank you very much, and hopefully see you in the next time. Thank you.